You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin today's show with Afghanistan. The extended peace talks between the United States and the insurgent Taliban have ignited hopes of peace in the war-torn country as both sides have agreed to prepare a framework for the further course of action. A six-day engagement in Qatar, which is being termed as significant progress, came up with the plan of a gradual departure of all US troops from Afghanistan in next 18 months and Taliban committing itself to not allowing foreign terrorist groups to operate from Afghan soil. Ashraf Ghani, however, has expressed his worries of US troops leaving the country. We have a report.
Weeks after President Donald Trump decided to withdraw all his 14,000 troops stationed in Afghanistan, the ramped-up diplomatic endeavors of the United States to bring insurgent Taliban to the negotiating table are bearing fruits. Although the exact details remain undisclosed, both sides have reportedly agreed to draft a peace deal which stipulates the withdrawal of foreign troops from Afghanistan within 18 months of the agreement being signed. Addressing the key demand of Washington, the Taliban, as a part of the deal, have assured that Afghanistan will not be allowed to be used by Al-Qaeda and Islamic State militants to attack the United States and its allies. These advances have been hailed by the US diplomats as well as decision makers. The US Defense Secretary, who still does not confirm of his troops returning, says the developments regarding the peace in the war-torn country were encouraging.
I'd say really the takeaway right now, it's encouraging, and we'll let Secretary Pompeo and the ambassador be the spokespersons for that.
Taliban, that has refused to engage with the Kabul establishment, calling it a puppet of the United States, says it will finalize timeline for a ceasefire in Afghanistan, but will only open talks with Afghan representatives once the ceasefire is implemented. Meanwhile, Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, after taking stock of the peace developments from Zelmay Khalilzad, State Special Envoy to Afghanistan, said that the keys to the war in Afghanistan were in Islamabad, Quetta, Rawalpindi, suggesting the neighbouring country was a safe haven for cross-border militant activities.
اما کلید جنگ په اسلام آباد کې ده په راولپنډي کې ده په کوټه کې ده
افغانستان has time and again accused Pakistan of turning a blind eye to Afghan Taliban commanders on its soil and even of supporting the militant group it is fighting. Ghani also questioned the religious legitimacy of the Taliban, who have repeatedly refused to hold direct peace talks with the Afghan government.
The way it is sarchina de mashruiyatam shariat de Indonesia ulama de Afghanistan ulama de Arabistan ulama pa yauz baider tu ele tentihar infijar saynalar.
In an effort to keep US military forces in Afghanistan, President Ashraf Ghani, who has grown wary of return of Taliban rule, is willing to discuss how to reduce the size and cost of maintaining America's military presence in the country. In a letter to Donald Trump, Ghani also invited the president to visit Afghanistan in the near future to review US-Afghan ties and discuss a mutually beneficial path forward towards lasting peace and increased security. Today, the hardline Islamic group control nearly half of Afghanistan and continues to stage nearly daily attacks against the Western-backed Afghan government and its security forces. Only days ago, it attacked an Afghan military compound, killing over 100 security forces, one of the most deadly insurgent attacks in months.
To provide more insights into the story, we have with us Mr. Anil Bhatt, a senior journalist who has been closely following the developments related to Afghanistan. Mr. Bhatt, President Ghani has sought an alternative of U.S. troop return. He wants to reduce the size and cost of maintaining America's military presence in the country. Do you think he wants Americans to stay for longer time?
President Ghani has expressed its concern on troop withdrawal from Afghanistan. He has a reason to say for this. He has quoted examples in the section of media comparing the Russia withdrawal and the proposed withdrawal of United States from the Afghanistan terror that may be within 1 year or most probably by next 2 years. He has in fact quoted and prevailed upon the United States administration to look and analyze the situation, what brought Afghanistan to the become a terror behave, a field of terror, violence, post withdrawal of Russian troops from Afghanistan. He has also serious concern about the stability, and the biggest thing that he has is that he is not the part of the talks.
Thank you, Mr. Bhatt. While the peace talks are gaining pace, let's talk about the development and change Afghanistan has witnessed since the ouster of the Taliban regime. When the war-torn country was ruled by Taliban, men had instructions of sporting bushy beards while women were denied education. They didn't dare venture out of their homes unless they had male family member with their faces or heads covered. However, the situation improved significantly in last few years. Let's see what people feel about Taliban's prospect in the country. A report.
Nearly two decades since the fall of the regime in 2001, life in Kabul and some of Afghanistan's larger cities is starting to catch up with the rest of the world. Health, education and infrastructure have improved, and along with its social freedoms have expanded. Millions of teenagers have lived through this transition, which has been volatile and under heavy guard by international troops whose presence peaked at 100,000 around 2010. Now some are enjoying careers and hobbies that may have seen them executed publicly had they tried to pursue them in the 1990s at the height of the Taliban control. There are still no hairdressing schools in Afghanistan, so Hussein was trained by one of his friends for 1 year in Western Herat province and now works in one of the few salons in the country. For Hussein, peace means short hair, blonde highlights, coiffures spotted by film stars.
می خوام که سر شه با طالبا کشور آرامی پیدا کنه مردم در کار خود برسه بچه ها دخترها بتونه برو مکتب درس بخونه دیگه که بچه ها بتونه موی خود هر رقمی که دوست دارن حالت بتن جور کنن.
With a draft peace agreement on the horizon, which would see the withdrawal of foreign troops within 18 months, teenagers are pondering their future. Piano virtuoso Mara Matai, 16, is cautiously optimistic that she will be able to continue her music, which along with television and other popular culture is seen as un-Islamic, according to the radical interpretation of Islamic law by the Taliban. Even now, some conservative Afghans look down on music, especially those using instruments.
چیزی که ما علاقه مندش هستیم دیگه او را انجام نتین، موسیقی را دوباره ادامه نتین، یعنی زیاد تنها همی چیز بر ما مشکل می باشه. اگر صلح به وجود بیاد بین دولت و طالبا یعنی خوب میشه، اما بخاطر یعنی اگر موسیقی را باشه ادامه داشته باشد و دخترها هم حقوق داشته باشن از خود.
In Taliban times, sports were also banned and the national stadium was infamous as a stage for brutality where public punishments were meted out on offenders of the regime's values. But now, men and increasingly women are undergoing training and winning medals in international competitions for sports such as Muay Thai, boxing. Kausar Sherzad, 17, has been brought up in Kabul, who started Muay Thai training 3 years ago and won 2 bronze medals last year in competitions held in South Korea and Thailand. She hopes that the Taliban will realize the potentials of Afghan athletes, as she and other female athletes have worked so hard to get where they are now.
ما فعلا در ورزش افغانستان دستاوردهای خیلی خوبی از بانوان افغانستان داریم که من خوشبین هستم که این را طالبان قبول میکنن.
The draft, which is a result of tireless diplomatic endeavors, includes assurances from the hardline Islamic group that will not allow Afghanistan to be used by Al-Qaeda and Islamic State to attack the US and its allies, a core US demand. Similar assurances involving other groups are given to Pakistan in the draft pack. Taliban sources say that they also want to be part of an interim government after any ceasefire.
Moving on to Pakistan, where the apex court has rejected the review petition against Asia Bibi, allowing her to move out of the country. The Christian woman who was on death row for years is now planning to move to Canada. A report.
Dismissing the review petition filed by the hardliners seeking execution of Asia Bibi, the Christian woman who was on death row since 2010 and was acquitted by Supreme Court guilty free in October, the apex court of Pakistan set her free, which now allows her to shift to any country across the globe. Bibi had been on death row since she was convicted in 2010 of making derogatory remarks against Islam, which she has always denied. Bibi spent 8 years on death row and was in hiding since the Supreme Court freed her in October owing to death threats issued by hardliners in the country. Under pressure from days of protests in the capital, Islamabad and other cities, the government agreed to stop Bibi leaving the country until the Supreme Court heard a review petition.
कोर्ट ने आईन और कानून के मुताबिक और अपनी साबिक जजमेंट्स के मुताबिक ये रिव्यू पिटीशन डिसमिस कर दी है और हमें नोटिस तक भी करना उन्होंने मुनासिब नहीं समझा कि इस दर्जे की फ्रिवलस वो पिटीशन थी और ऑनरेबल चीफ जस्टिस ने करेक्टली ये ऑब्जर्व किया कि अगर ये ऐसा केस ना होता जो जिसमें जज्बात इन्वॉल्व हैं तो वो इन गवाहों के खिलाफ पर्चा दर्ज करवाते चूँकि इन्होंने ऑन ओथ झूठी स्टेटमेंट्स.
Asia Bibi, who is now in a protective custody, was charged with blasphemy after neighbors working in the fields with her objected to her drinking water from their glass because she was not Muslim. Her conviction was overturned in October, prompting protests from religious hardliners calling for her death and demanding that the government prevent her from leaving the country. She has always denied committing blasphemy.
Asia Bibi ke bare mein to mera khayal hai kyunki sab ulma ne ye kaha ki Supreme Court ke faisle ke bawajood usko wo qatl kar denge to usko to mera khayal jana hi chahiye lekin mera aap se vaada hai ki main aapke saath marunga yahin pe isi mulk. Now she will enjoy and relax rest of her life in some good country.
Pakistan has always remained a conservative state, and with the promulgation of the blasphemy law by military dictator Zia-ul-Haq, the society became even more intolerant towards the minorities. A person convicted under these laws is given death sentence. Asia Bibi's case is not an exclusive case where minorities were subjected to repression through a legislation. The case, however, gained prominence when former governor of Pakistan's Punjab province, Salman Taseer, was killed in 2011 for supporting her and criticizing the blasphemy laws. A month after Taseer was killed, Pakistan's religious minorities minister, Shahbaz Bhatti, a Christian who spoke out against the blasphemy law, was shot dead in Islamabad. Asiya's case has been hugely divisive in the country, which is very religiously conservative. Thousands protested in October when her conviction was first overturned. Canada is in talks with Pakistan about helping her claim asylum abroad if she is allowed to leave.
Pakistan has been misruling the region of Gilgit-Baltistan for more than 7 decades. In order to accomplish its materialistic agendas, it has been meting out different forms of atrocities at indigenous people. While the repressive designs are largely political, sometimes they are physical and economic as well. In the absence of adequate irrigation land, the youth of the region is compelled to seek jobs in government and the private sector. However, Pakistan's nefarious agenda of not letting private sector enter the region and not letting the people of the region becoming part of government departments has left the youth of the region reeling under an endemic wave of unemployment. We bring you a report.
One of the myriad reasons of mounting distress among the people of the occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan is growing unemployment rate. And it is not just the illiterate who are affected, even the highly educated youth is wandering empty pocket. While some say it is poor implementation of policies, others accuse Islamabad of engineering and executing repression. People say a dwindling economy, poverty and denial of fundamental rights coupled with rampant corruption have further worsened the situation. The assembly and representatives of the region have been vested with little powers, and the people who are holding the region's reign from Islamabad have been systematically pushing it towards misery. People who once had the control over the policies and affairs of the region have tactically been thrown out of the decision-making bodies, and the new frameworks have been introduced to cater the needs, wishes and luxuries of Islamabad. Arguing the structural reforms being pursued by Pakistan and in process, the damages being done, an optimistic Zafarullah Khan, the Deputy Speaker of Gilgit-Baltistan Assembly, has put numerous propositions to do away with the crisis, but sadly nobody has paid attention to him.
हमें बहुत कुछ वहां से मिलने की तवक्को थी तो अभी तो यहां हमें नजर नहीं आ रहा है सच पाकिस्तान से अब ये देखो जो हमारा ऑर्डर था 2018 वाला उसका भी हुलिया बिगाड़ के रख दिया जो इख्तियारात जीबी को ट्रांसफर हुए थे अब जीबी से उठा के वापस फेडरल को दे दिया तो वहां एक इस वक्त लोगों के अंदर गम और गुस्सा पाया जाता है तो अब इसको ठंड हम किस तरह करें इसके लिए यह है कि यूथ को हम एंगेज करें यूथ को ज्यादा से ज्यादा एम्प्लॉयमेंट दे दें उसके साथ-साथ हम जो फॉरेन है दुनिया भर में जहां भी सिकुलर जाते हैं या मुलाजमत करने के लिए मौके अपॉर्चुनिटीज मिलते हैं तो यहां फेडरल गवर्नमेंट को चाहिए कि वो हमारा कोटा रखे गिलगित बल्तिस्तान का वहां के लोग वहां के जो सिकुलर हैं वहां के हुनरमंद अफराद जो है वो वहां जाए बरौनी ममालिक तो वहां से जो है वो कमा के यहां रिमिटेंस में भेजेंगे और उनका रोजगार भी होगा उनका घर का चूल्हा भी जलेगा
The mounting crisis is not a result of the Pakistani economy that has witnessed an unprecedented slump lately, but perennial cruelty which marginalized locals have been subjected to ever since the invasion of the region. The locals have made repeated demands seeking the consolidation of the private sector in the region. However, all their pleas have fallen on deaf ears of authorities who do not want to let the region get developed.
हाँ एग्रीकल्चर लैंड जो है वो ना होने के बराबर है उसके अलावा वहाँ पे इंडस्ट्रीज नहीं है प्राइवेट सेक्टर ना होने के बराबर है तो अब अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट की जो बात हो रही है वहाँ सारा डिपेंड जो है वो गवर्नमेंट के इदारों के ऊपर है जीबी में जितने गवर्नमेंट के इदारे हैं वहाँ पाकिस्तान से और दुनिया भर से सबसे ज़्यादा जो है एम्प्लॉयज़ गिलगित बल्तिस्तान के इदारों में हैं तकरीबन 25% से ज़्यादा लोग एम्प्लॉयज़ हैं इन्हीं इदारों में जो एग्जिस्टिंग गिलगित बल्तिस्तान में इदारे हैं और हमारी ये कोशिश भी है ख्वाहिश भी होती है जब भी जहाँ भी गवर्नमेंट में हम जाके बात करते हैं तो हम यही कहते हैं कि जनाब हमारी यूथ जो है वो अनएम्प्लॉय बहुत ज़्यादा है और उनके लिए एक तो यह है कि वहाँ पे प्राइवेट सेक्टर लगाया जाए यानी इंडस्ट्रीज हो वहाँ पे ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा और उसके साथ साथ जो हमारे वहाँ पे थोड़ी बहुत एग्रीकल्चर लैंड है और माइनिंग का शोबा है, मिनरल्स है, उनसे इस्तेफादा हासिल करें।
The status of the region has always been in a limbo, with Islamabad ruling the region through ad hoc executive orders. These orders are basically used as a suppressive tool to keep the indigenous people under check and are aimed at curtailing the fundamental rights of the citizens of Gilgit-Baltistan. Latest in the list, the GB Order 2018, which transferred all the powers vested with the GB authorities to the federal government, was introduced to facilitate the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, an ambitious multi-billion economic project that has hit multiple roadblocks owing to earlier status. Activists who have dared to resist the joint ambitions of Pakistan and China have been slapped with sedition charges. The draconian Schedule 4, which in reality brought to bring such situation control, has been used indiscriminately.
Moving on, India for past few years is witnessing a great upsurge in its fashion industry, with strong drivers of growth and host of other factors resulting in its progress. Moreover, with international developments like India Fashion Week and several shows held across major cities of the country, the industry has surely moved to a blossoming takeoff. Lakme Fashion Week, held twice a year in the showbiz capital, Mumbai, is one among these fashion extravaganzas that recently came up with its 39th edition.
The country's most coveted names in the fashion industry brought alive the unmitigated splendor during the 5-day-long Lakme Fashion Week as they displayed their exuberant collections. The fashion jamboree began with Gaurav Gupta's collection unfolding that saw poetess Navkirat Sodhi performing while suspended on an aerial harness that rolled out the red carpet. Bollywood actress Tabu, who sashayed down the ram in a powder Cleo Chinkari gown, and director-producer Karan Johar, who looked stunning in a black ensemble and red blazer featuring heavy silver and black embellishments, turned the muse for the designer. While evergreen Tabu was a show opener, Johar was a showstopper for the designer, who together opened the Lakme Fashion Week with a bang.
The collection is called Unfolding. It was unfolding with all the origamic structures that you see on Tabu's gown as well. And then we did a lot of new techniques of chikankari, you know, chikankari mixing with our technique.
Fashion designer Gauri and Nainika set the stage on fire with their collection titled The Art of Latte, inspired by colors of different flavors of the brio drink. Coffee showcased a wide range of dresses designed for the contemporary women. Bollywood actress Yami Gautam, who was showstopper for the designer, spread royalty at the event as she sashayed down the ram in her light pink gown.
You have many fans in the industry, and so many girls out there that love Gauri and Anikari creations. I think they're absolutely spectacular, they're beautiful, and comes with a certain class and elegance. So thank you so much for having me exhibit that.
Inclination towards sustainable fashion too came into light in the Fashion Week with a collection by designer Jyoti Reddy, who created a fusion of India and Western aesthetics, saris combined with cropped blouses and loose pants. Meanwhile, designer Anita Dongre incorporated the fiber regenerated from oud cellulose in her Indian designs of flowing skirts and kurtas.
We're very happy to be partnering with Tencel. At the house of Anita Dongre, we are looking at partners that are sustainable, that are sustainably minded, just like we are. And I think this is the beginning of a great partnership.
With stalwarts from the industry, along with new talent showcasing their collection, the 39th edition of Lakme Fashion Week celebrated various aspects of fashion, ranging from inclusivity to handlooms.
Though as compared to global fashion industry, India contributes a meager share, but over the past few years, the country has emerged as one of the world's fastest growing fashion markets, which definitely promises it a brighter future. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.